Good morning, Freedom Center. How many are living free from deception today? Amen. Listen, God has not changed his mind about his word. He has not changed his mind about the lighthouse. He has not changed his mind about you. Amen? Those that are here joining us this morning, thank you for coming. Those that are watching live on YouTube and Facebook, welcome and thank you. Today's a Faith Home graduation. This is our fourth graduation of the year. And the Lord has not changed his mind about making disciples through the Faith Home. What is the Faith Home? The Faith Home is still an 18-month discipleship ministry. We don't even say drug program because we don't even talk about drugs. When I do the intakes that come in, I rarely ask them, what was your drug of choice? Because it really doesn't matter. We're 18 months of heart. We deal with your heart. We deal with the root. That's what we're interested in. Amen? Pastor Tony, thank you for that powerful word. Right on time. Amen? So the 18 months program, it's a 12-month curriculum that has classes that deal with compulsive desires, renewing their mind, Holy Spirit, faith. All these classes are strategically put in place to bring that issue out. Not the drugs, not the alcohol. That's corny. We don't even talk about that. And so after the 12 months, they get to practice what they've learned, this new life. It's not a changed life, because God gives you a brand new life. Amen? And so in those 6 months is where they're practical living. It's okay to fall on your face because that's part of discipleship. So for those 6 months, they're able to, one, if they want to serve here, if that's what the Lord puts in their heart, they could do a six-month internship. And if they decide to go to work, that's great too. We are connected with different employers. Everyone that's decided to go to work has gotten a job. Amen. And that's what the discipleship looks like. Today we're having a graduation. This brother that I'm going to call up here, he is a real example of what 12 months curriculum looks like and what 6 months of practicing this new life. And in that, gifts have come out. How many know that they said the cemetery has the most treasure? That's a lie. It's right here at the lighthouse, right here in the Faith Home. And so I'm really honored to present this brother to come up here. He was my assistant for a short season as he was walking into his calling. He is a blessing. Mr. John Worsham.
Told myself I was going to come up here with boldness. That just went out the window. I came to the Lighthouse November 20th in 2018. The better part of the 15 years before that, drugs and alcohol controlled my life, wrecked my life. I saw a career as a software engineer deteriorate into a point where I found myself hacking my own company I worked for. It got to a point, at one point I was even exploring developing pornographic websites. Anything I could do to make extra money, because the $75,000 a year salary I was making was not enough to pay for groceries anymore. It wasn't enough to pay the rent. It wasn't enough to make the car payment. I was kind of like Mr. Anderson during the day and a darker version of Neo at night, but the blue pill I swallowed got me high. I got so high one day that I decided to quit my job because I wanted to focus more on illicit websites and making my fortune that way. That didn't happen. I lost pretty much everything. I lost, the money was gone, the drugs were gone, and all I was left with was this deep depression that I quickly filled with alcohol. A lot of it for a long time, for a period of years, has escalated all the way to the point that I shot out my nervous system and ended up 75% paralyzed. It took a few months of recovering from that. I figured that would be a lesson for me to quit drinking, and I did for a while. And I figured, well, I'll just move back home where I grew up and start over, everything would be better, but really it just got worse. And so my dad delivered me here. Coming into 2019, the word of the year was be still. There's a tree out here on the fence line I attached that word to because it drew my attention every day. I would be sitting on the back porch reading my Bible. And that tree stood out from the rest for some reason, but every day I looked at it, it was like it was trying to tell me something. I began drawing that tree in my journal, and actually it was on the cover, I drew it on the cover page of my first class project. And then one day I was sitting out there looking at that tree, and I looked down at my Bible, and I read that I will be like that tree planted by the rivers of water. And I will bear fruit in my season. My flesh will not wither, and whatever I do will prosper. And from that moment on, that became my life verse. And Psalms 1:3 was the foundation that I stood on for 18 months in the faith home. And I went after this thing hard as I could, because this was it for me. This was the end. There was no choice left for me to take. I had to get this right, and I had to get it right now, because this was life or death. There was no red pill I could swallow to make it all go away. So I went after this process as hard as I could, and through this process, I discovered that there's a purpose greater than me. And in that purpose, I found my identity, an identity that allowed me to walk in obedience and humility that God wanted me to be in so that I could receive what he was trying to do for me. And it took a while of that, and I finally realized that that wall out there across the bridge was telling me that the work started in me would be complete, and that Philippians 1:6 will be a fulfilled prophecy of the rest of my life. And things started coming to me. There's a pot in the kitchen. It was the dirtiest pot I ever seen, and I could never get it clean. And I just wanted to throw the thing away, but God was trying to tell me that you will be clean, but it's not going to be quick, and it's not going to be easy. It's going to take time. It's going to take patience. It's going to take hard work and discipline. But in the end, while you may not be perfect, you will be new again. One day, standing in the chapel at prayer, I was looking out the window to that empty field, and the Lord showed me a lot of crops growing out there. And for a long time, I thought I was called here to grow vegetables. but I realized later that I think he was showing me something else, that anything planted here is going to grow. So here I am today, delivered from darkness, a renewed mind, renewed hope, and a future right in front of my face right now. And it took a lot of people, really. It wasn't just me, and I give all the glory to God, but there were a lot of people involved in getting me to stand here right now before you. And I want to acknowledge them, if I may, real quick. And I'll begin with Pastor Tony, Pastor Jeanette. I want to really just thank you for being who you are, being the leaders of this church and this ministry, and for your support of the Faith Home that allows guys like me who maybe lost their way to come here and find their way again. I thank you very much for that. And Pastor Ralph and Pastor Diane, just for the love, cause I just look at you two and all I see is love. And I just thank you for that. Thank you for all of that. Pastor Wally, for guiding me, for keeping me straight, straight on that path you made for me, that I could walk through that door you opened for me. I thank you for that. Richard Fernandez. Your heart, you have one of the biggest hearts I've ever seen. As much as you've been through and as much as you go through every day, you still come out the other side with one of the biggest hearts I've ever seen. And and that heart is what allowed you to listen to me one day when I thought no one else was listening to me, and you remembered. Thank you. Nikki Santana, first, I just want to tell you that it is a pleasure and a privilege and an honor to work alongside you in media. And I want to thank you very much and so much. I'm so grateful to you for giving me the space and the freedom to follow my inspirations in the media department and knowing that we're just getting started. Elliot Cook. I look at you and I see what could have been myself 10 years ago. I want to thank you for inspiring me and challenging me, not just up here, but more importantly, in here. I thank you for that. You're an inspiration. I want to thank a member of my family here today, too. My Aunt Marie is here with my father. I want to thank you, Aunt Marie, for having what would be the most important phone number of my life to make the most important phone call of my life that got me here in 2018. Thank you very much. And lastly, I want to thank my dad for delivering me here and for sticking by me when I didn't know if anybody else was sticking by me through this whole thing. And just so you know, you saved my life, and I maybe in some way of going through this together with you, I saved your life too in some way. Amen. So, well, what's the future hold? Well, I'm going to let God take care of the long term, but for the immediate right now, I'm going to finish what I started here. Because I don't think I'm done with Philippians 1:6 yet. I think God's got more in store for me right here. So this is where I'm staying planted. And, you know, it's been said that I used to work for the devil. I work for Jesus now.
Hallelujah. Yes, give God some praise for that testimony. Would the family of John Worsham please come up for a picture? The family of John Worsham, please come up for a picture. Hallelujah. That's exactly what the faith home looks like.
I just want to say that for all of you that have sown, don't see yourself. This is your harvest right here, right now. I know we sow and we hear good things, but then we ask ourselves, what's the harvest? Listen, the harvest stands before you right now. Here, 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 all around this room. This next young man I would like to call up, he's another one that had to make a decision. You know, when you have kids and children, that's your heart. That is a big decision. What do you do? Do you submit to what your leaders are saying because they know there's a better life if you go through the process? Or do you run out to make more money because you think that's what would keep your kids? And this next guy we'll have to call up is Michael Moore.
I'd like to start out by thanking everybody. First of all, Pastor Tony, Pastor Jeanette for being speaking into my life. Pastor Wally, Brother Richard, Brother Elliot for y'all making this thing look cool. You know what I mean? You guys make this thing look good. I'd like to thank Brother Massey, Miss Joelle, again Elliot, a lot of the teachers that teach these classes because there's just something special. I can't even have words for it, really. Really, all the chapel speakers that come in and pour into us, John Warren, Michael Carter, I mean, there's just too many names to mention, really. The Nosworthy Effect. and also a big, huge thanks to my cousin for kind of paving the way, and to my mother and Benny for pushing me, making me make a decision. I didn't know at that time that, see, I'm gonna cry already, that decision would be the decision that could change my life. So I'll start out with, my name is Michael Loy. I'm 39 years old. I grew up mostly in Tampa with my mother and my brother. I felt like I had a pretty fun childhood, pretty normal childhood. I had a father that lived out of the state, and I rarely seen him. The only memories I really have of him, I can only call memories of my brother, because hanging out with him. My mother worked nights, so I stayed with my Aunt Niecy and my cousins, Gary and Mikey. But I had a pretty good childhood. I started smoking pot and smoking cigarettes and playing with alcohol at a pretty young age. But I eventually moved out of that. I got into martial arts, which kept me doing that stuff usually on the weekends. Fast forward to I graduated. Shortly after that, I got with the mother of my two beautiful boys, Michael and Jackson. Let's see. I was with her for 12 years. I thought I did pretty good. But I really wasn't, because really selling drugs and working was all I really ever did. But I kept the household going for a long time, and I thought that's what I was supposed to do, and I thought that's all I had to do. I didn't get along with her that well a lot of the times. We tried to keep together for the kids, but when we split up, I jumped into another relationship really fast, because I didn't know how to deal with that. I was pretty broken from it, didn't know how to deal with my feelings, so I ran from them. So I started using even more at that point. It became not just always partying, it was just a lifestyle. Let's see, my mother and my kids took my kids to Pennsylvania trying to get me to leave the girl because she seen the bad path I was going on, and that kind of backfired. That's when I started using IV drugs. From that point on, it was just a downward spiral. I moved into really doing meth and heroin, which made it even worse. Last December, I died three times within like a three-week period. And finally, my mother said something to me that kind of broke through. She said, "What do you want me to tell your kids when you don't wake up next time?" And that made me think a lot. And then I had my brother come and confront me. And he seen me. I looked really bad. I was up at like 5 days at that point, over and over. I was doing that. It was a lifestyle. But again, I thought because I had my own place, I had a job, and I did my own thing, I wasn't hurting nobody. But that was just a deception. It was just a lie. Really, coming here, it was the biggest decision I feel like I've made in a very long time. When I got here, I learned that really the biggest enemy was myself, because I seen my life through a broken lens. Drugs, relationships, shame, guilt, all these things just stole my identity and kept me down. I was living depressed. It wasn't until I got here and I slowed down and I lost my views on religion and learned to hear my father's voice and build a relationship with him through prayer, the Bible, the stuff that we're taught here. They're learning the classes by learning his character, by knowing who he is. I also learned that he's a God of covenant, which means I have a part, and he has a part. One of the things that really stuck out to me was we have a brother that comes here, Michael Carter, that preaches to us, Pastor Carter. And one of the things that really stuck out to me, he said, the only ability that God needs from us is our availability. So I had to surrender, because only a surrendered heart can be led, guided, or directed in the right path. I had to let go of my past and forgive myself and some people in my life, but mostly myself. That was a huge hurdle for me. I have it on my boots even when I worked here. I worked maintenance, but I have worthy written on my boots to remind me all the time. I heard something that really stuck out to me. I don't even know where it came from, but it said that a man doesn't die from falling into the river. He dies from staying submerged. So I needed to swim and fight, but I needed a direction. I needed a stronger foundation. I was asked one time, what does a man of God do? And I was told that anything he has to do, it takes a man to say, I'm going to face this and fix it. So I had to come here surrendered. I've learned to trust God. Like he said earlier, Pastor Tony, we learn what the real thing is here so we can spot a fake. There's no counterfeits here. I learned how to feed my faith and to build upon the foundation, which is now my rock and my salvation. Looking forward to continuing to growing in my relationship with God. There's a verse that I like, and it's John 8:12, and it says, Jesus spoke, saying that I'm the light of the world, and anyone that follows after me will never walk in darkness again, and will have the light of life. So I'm looking forward to the rest of my life being the best of my life.
Amen. Hallelujah. Give God some praise for that graduate. With a family of Michael Lloyd, please come up, take a picture. This is my Michael Lloyd's family, please come up for a picture. Praise God. Hallelujah. Yes.
This is exactly what the Lord does through the faithful. It restores back everything and gives you a brand new, fresh, that you never knew life. Amen. People that are here and those that are watching us live, if you know anyone that's hurting, that's suffering, we know a way. We know a way. Lighthouse, find us. 813-677-5220. We're going to get ready to take a faith home offering. Yes. You just seen a fresh harvest, but if you look around, there's already harvests here from the past. I would like to call up this brother. He is a faith home graduate. He is a chapel speaker. He even helps the brothers, those that don't have family. He asks them, what do you need? You need hygiene. You need anything. You need reading glasses. And he does that faithfully every month. And I would like to call up Mr. Gonzalo Sanchez.
On the whole world, and I'm about to tell you the reason why, but just give me a minute to just to honor the God did from the beginning with Dr. Leonard. He was faithful and obeying God, and his daughter, Pastor Ralph, I honor Pastor Hank, is in the presence of God today, and I honor you, Pastor Tony, because you, after God's heart, real, you are the real deal. Yeah. Yes, sir. Yes, sir. And listen, church, we have a young pastor. We're going to have a long, long time real deal pastor. Listen, I came here on 2004, June, bound by ignorance, by the lack of knowledge. Even though I was raised in church, I'm from a small country in Central America called Panama. And because of that, I didn't know how to deal with relationship, with any relationship, because I didn't know how to deal and face situations. But God, that caused me to run away and use drugs and alcohol until I hit a rock bottom. And then my wife, so faithful, picked me up and brought me home. And looked with me for help. And this was the only place that opens the door for me to be taught the knowledge of God, to set me apart and use these people then to pour me and teach me what the plan of God was for me in my life. Thanks be to my Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. You know, I learned to blow him a kiss every morning to go to work. Daddy, thank you so much. You know, I'm not ashamed of that. Every father, it should be melt you down. It should kid blow you a kiss. You know, so I mean, it's a constant. You're seeing what you're seeing here, and you're seeing the real deal, that God's presence is each and every day in our life. If you look around, you know, we're gathered together here today. I mean, I look around my family, they're all okay. I haven't stopped working since all this craziness, so I'll be able to provide, you know, for my family, you know, again, the respect of everybody. Hey, listen, I working with the man that I was stealing from him. And today, he saw the change. And today, he won't let me go. Because, you know, just what God did to me turned this thing that was going into the path of death, turning into a beauty, into asset to society. And that's what I do. I'm a handyman. And I can go into your house, and any ugliness in your house, I will turn it into beauty. Yeah. Woo! And that's what God does, though. You know, he took me, saved me, and made me a society, you know, a good man. You know, and also, I want to take the opportunity to honor my wife, because, you know, you gonna see a God that God is real. She drops everything for house and family to go with me to my country to take care of my mother. That she was dying. And she said, baby, let's go, I'll help you and taking care of her. I was crying when I was remembering that. I remember it all the time what God has done for my life. So we went. And she has to come back because it was not, it's total different. But guess what? She came back and started working her back off as a teacher for 3.5 years. We were separate until I get my legal papers. But you know what happened? Bam, God stepped in, you know? During those 3.5 years, the love of God was so faithful. I got no business out of my house where I was living by myself. And she was faithful too. She hired a lawyer and brought his husband back home. Woo! Today, and you know what? That's the gift from the Lord himself, my beautiful wife. And we just growing together. Our marriage is so exciting. I mean, I can't wait to go home to my beautiful wife. Woo! So she has, you know, all these people that they know the ripple effect of giving into this ministry. Dr. Leno is. He knew what's going to happen. And Dr. Hank, Pastor Hank, and so forth. And it's just because you're giving into a good ground. So I thank you. I thank you, everybody, the staff that deal with this young. I call myself wild because I came here doing whatever I want to do. And being transformed, I call the boot camp of the living God, where we become a special forces of the army of the living God. Yes. Thank you, Lord.
Hallelujah. Yes. The special army of the Lord. Yes. Yes, amen. Ushers, please take your place. People of God, listen. It doesn't matter what it is. Even if it's just your heart, come up here and touch this wheelbarrow. We need your faith. Not just about monetary, your faith too. I want to share this. I had an intake this week in my office, and we were doing the process and the screening and, you know, all that good stuff.
And the intake asked me a powerful question that I got the answer last night from the Lord. He said, "Mr. Richard, what is you guys' success rate?" I didn't have a verbal answer, but instantly images started popping up. All the soldiers that are here. And last night, it's like I heard the Lord say 100%. And so I would like all the Faith Home graduates, would you please stand up and raise your hand so this guy could see the 100% increase. 100%. 100%. That's our success rate for those that are willing. You got to submit to the Lord. You submit to the Lord, and he will finish what he set out to do in your life. Amen. We have an awesome pastor that preaches with fire. He's from the Faith Home. We have another pastor, Pastor Waldemar. He doesn't see these men for their mistakes. He sees right through that and sees their calling in their life. We have so many soldiers here that are in here and they live out there, living their life through the Faith Home. It's the Faith Home. Amen? So, ushers, envelopes, people that want to give, please give. I encourage you to do it. And if not, just come up here and be in agreement with us and touch these wheelbarrows. Apply your faith right now in Jesus' name. If you've been ambassadors for Christ, please take your place. Church, ushers, release the people.
If you've been hearing the same old voice, tell the same old lies. If you're trying to fill the same old holes inside, there's a better life. There's a better life. If you got pain, he's a pain taker. If you feel lost, he's a way maker. If you need freedom, a savior, he's a prison shaking savior. If you got chains, he's a chain breaker. We've all searched for the light of day in the dead of night. We've all found ourselves worn out from the same old fight. We've all run to things we know just ain't right. And there's a better life. There's a better life. You got pain, he's a pain taker. If you feel lost, he's a way maker. If you need freedom, a savior, he's a prison shaker. Chains, oh, he's a chain breaker.
Father, in the name of Jesus Christ, Lord. Thank you for this day, Father God. Thank you that we're able to give, Father God. That we're able to give with our hearts, Lord Jesus. Right now, Father God, with your permission, we ask, Father God, to open the gates of heaven, Father God, and let the seed go and grow in the name of Jesus. Lord, we ask for a double portion of soldiers to rise up out of the Faith Home, Father God. We thank you, Lord. We praise you, Father God. And Lord, we offer this, Father God, because it's pleasing to you. In Jesus' name, amen.
Dark tears away, stepped in and saved.
Hallelujah. Yeah.